I want to welcome all of you. Amen. On a day like this, for God's people to come out, it's a blessing. You blessed me. And you will be blessed.
Yes.
I welcome our visitors with us today also. God bless you. Things God won't ask on that day. God won't ask what kind of car you drove. He'll ask how many people you drove who didn't have transportation. God won't ask the square footage of your home. He'll ask how many people you welcomed into your home. God won't ask about the clothes you had in your closet. He'll ask how many you helped to clothe. God won't ask what your highest salary was. He'll ask if you compromised your character to obtain it. God won't ask what your title was. He'll ask if you performed your job to the best of your ability. God won't ask how many friends you had. He'll ask how many people to whom you were a friend. God won't ask in what neighborhood you lived. He'll ask how you treated your neighbors.
Okay,
maybe I should read that one more time. God won't ask about the color of your skin. He'll ask about the contents of your character. Yeah. So last week I spoke from 1 Chronicles chapter 4, verses 9 to 10. About a prayer that a guy prayed. It's recorded in the Bible by the name of Jabez. It's coming. In his prayer, he prayed a bold prayer. And I would say a prayer that would stretch anyone's faith. And here it is, verse 10. It's 1 Chronicles chapter 4, verse 10. Oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory, that your hand would be with me, and that you would keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain. So God granted his request. That, to me, reading that part of that scripture just really means a lot to me. He prays a big, bold prayer, and then God says he granted his request. I pray big prayers because I want to see big things happen. And I also pray big prayers when I believe God has put something on my heart, and I won't quit praying about it until I get what I feel is a release from God to quit praying for that, or a release assuring me that he has answered that prayer. Sometimes when God puts something on your heart, you need to keep praying until you have an answer. And as a result of last Sunday's message, somebody came up to me and asked a very common question. And the question was this: if God doesn't answer my prayer, is it because I don't have any faith? So I want to ask you, or I want us to look at that this morning together. And let's first look at this word called faith. Romans chapter 12, verse 3 says, "For I say, through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, as God has dealt to each one a measure of faith." I believe that each one of us is given, I want you to follow me on this, the same amount of faith when you ask Jesus to come into your heart. And I say that because in that verse that we just read, it says, "So no one can think of themselves any better than the other." None of us are any better than anyone else. We're all equal at this point. So you may wonder why, when you see one person pray, that you see all kinds of miracles following after them. And then you watch somebody else pray and you don't see the same results. So what's going on here? Matthew chapter 17, verse 20, Jesus said, "If you have faith as a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, 'Move from here to there,' and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you." When I read that verse, I think, how awesome is that? Most of us read that verse and think, well, a mustard seed is really small, so I don't need to have a whole lot of faith to see God do anything through me. But if you read the verse again, it's not referring to its size. It says faith as or faith like a mustard seed. So follow me for just a minute here with this. It's God's desire that your faith be like a mustard seed. So what's a mustard seed like? It's tiny. Yes. God has planted a tiny seed within us. Not only is it probably the smallest seed in the garden that you have seen or that you've looked at, but when it's planted, it grows to be a rather large plant. So your faith needs to be planted. It must be cultivated. It must be taken care of like other plants in the garden. You can't realize the benefits of the mustard plant unless you put it to use. You've got to put it to use. If you want your faith to grow, you've got to use it. And that's part of the point here. Luke chapter 17, verse 5, the apostle said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." I want my faith increased. In fact, I'd be one of the first ones to jump up and say, I want it to grow. I want my faith to grow. I don't want to stay in the same spot in my walk with God. I want my life to grow in Him. And I want my mustard seed, that faith in my life, to grow in my walk with Him. All Christians should want their faith to grow. And I think all Christians want their faith to grow, but it's just that all of them don't want to do what's necessary to make their faith grow. Yes. Lord, increase my faith. Lord, make my faith to grow. And here's how that happens. Romans chapter 10, verse 17. So then faith comes by hearing. And anyone want to finish that? And hearing? By the word of God. So you know what that verse says, that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So what do you have to do to make your faith grow? But first of all, you read that and it sounds, wow, this is really simple, right? Causing your faith to grow, it's really simple. God lays it right out in front of us. But we need to not only read God's word, but we need to study His word also. And live His word. And in doing this, you draw closer to God. Your relationship with Him increases as you read the Bible. One of the things that you need to do the most is be in God's Word. How many of you, when you open the Word, you sit down and you start to read the Bible, and you just kind of go, you fall asleep? You know, that happens. I see a lot of smiles, so that tells me you understand what I'm talking about. But power through that and get back to it and begin to read His Word. And in doing this, like I said, we draw closer to Him. Your relationship increases with Him. And as you read the Bible, ask God to reveal Himself to you. Ask Him to make His Word real to you. You know, God makes it as simple as He can. Not only does He want a closer relationship with Him, in Luke chapter 22, verse 32, it says, I have prayed for you that your faith should not fail. You know, isn't that awesome, knowing that God is praying for you?
Yes.
God's praying for me. When we go through trials, God's praying for us. Boy, thank you for that. Now, I should have done this in the very beginning, but here's what the Bible gives us, the definition of faith. Found in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. If you ever want the definition of faith, it's found in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. It says, now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. The New Living Translation says, faith is the confidence that what we hope for will actually happen. And it gives us assurance about things we cannot see. I like that definition here. Faith is the confidence that what we hope for will actually happen. You ever think of it that way? You ever have that confidence or a lack of confidence? This means that what you hope for has substance or is a reality because of your faith, and faith is the evidence that you hoped for, or that what you hoped for is a reality. So do you have the confidence that what you ask will actually happen? Do you have that confidence that when you pray and you go to God in prayer, that when you ask something specific, that God's going to answer that prayer? Some of us, when we pray, we'll ask something big of God. How many of you ever ask big prayers? I mean,
yes.
Okay, you do. Good. So when you pray, and we ask something big of God, and then when you think of what you asked for, you start thinking, oh my, should I really have asked that? I know I've done that. Man, maybe I should have said, no, God, well, here's what you can really do. You know, you don't really have to answer that prayer, but if you, because your confidence is not big enough to follow along with what you asked for. In other words, they aren't confident that God will answer that prayer. Be confident. Nothing wavering. Be assured. You know for a fact that God will do it. You understand what the Word says, that nothing is impossible with God.
According to His will.
That's right. Confidence that God will do it. Several years ago, I had a person come up for prayer that had severe neck and back pains, problems. And I believe that God was going to heal that particular individual as I was praying for him. I just felt, you know, I had confidence, 100% confidence that God was going to heal. And when I finished praying, as soon as I finished, this lady steps up behind the guy that I just prayed for and says, you know what, you know, the doctors can't do anything. I've had the same thing happen in my life, and there's just nothing that they can do. And there's no way that anything is ever going to change in your life. And I'm going, oh my. And I had already stepped over to pray for somebody else. And in my mind, as I'm praying for that next person, I'm going, yeah. What just happened here? They convinced the person that I just prayed for that there's no way that they can be healed Because the doctors can't do anything for them. They sowed disbelief. They sowed everything negative that you can think about into that person. I want to look at Peter for just a moment. You mentioned Peter. We use him as an example for all kinds of things, don't we? But Peter, one of Jesus' disciples, you remember the guy that denied knowing Jesus? You remember the guy that cut off the ear of the soldier that came to take Jesus away? Not showing a whole lot of confidence in his walk with his Lord. And also remember Peter, the guy that saw Jesus walking on the water. Asked Jesus to let him come to him. And he steps out of the boat. And I want you to hear these next few words really clear with his eyes on Jesus. And he begins walking towards him. And then he looks at his circumstances around him. As you read the account in the Word, you know that there was a storm going on at that time. And the disciples are in a boat out in the water, and Jesus is coming to them. And the circumstances that he was facing at that time was a storm going on around him. A storm that was raging, and he took his eyes off of Jesus. But each of the things, you know, I mentioned about Peter is all about Peter growing. He definitely stepped out of his comfort zone when he stepped out of the boat. And you know, one of the things that came to mind just now, even in spite of all these things that we think about Peter, Jesus said, upon this rock I will build my church. He grew. He grew in his walk with God. Many of us have the confidence to put our toes in the water, right? You know, there's a storm around you. You see Jesus walking. You say, hey, Jesus, let me come to you. And you're kind of go, okay, let's test the water here a little bit. You know, I'm going to get my feet wet. But that confidence to take that complete step out of the boat, that's a tough one. That's a tough one. What do you think Moses was thinking about when he arrived at the Red Sea? He's got the nation of Israel following him. They had just left Egypt. And they arrive at the Red Sea, and God told them that they were going to cross over on dry ground. You have the Egyptians, that army pursuing them. Do you think he was looking at the circumstances? Can you picture in your mind if it was you instead of Moses? What would you be thinking of at the time? Oh my God, how are we going to get across this? Where are we going now? God, what'd you get us out here for? Kind of sounds like what the people were saying behind him. We're going to cross it on dry ground. Is that really what you said, God? Did I hear you right? Again, don't look at your circumstances. Don't look at what's going on around you. Put your trust and your confidence in God. When you pray, put your confidence in the guy that you're praying to. Put your faith in him with nothing wavering. In other words, like Peter, Jesus said, come, you step right out and you start going. Like Moses, God said, stretch out your arm. Have no hesitation to do what God tells you to do. Just step out with confidence and assurance, knowing that what God said to do, he's going to do. Amen. That mountain that it talks about, Matthew chapter 17, 20, verse 20, the second portion of it says, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move. And nothing will be impossible for you. Hallelujah. Isn't that exciting? And nothing will be impossible for you. Jesus said, it will move.
Yes.
Jesus said, it will be done in Matthew 21, 21. Jesus said, it will come to pass, found in Mark 11, 23. Jesus said, it will obey you, found in Luke chapter 17, verse 6. Nothing will be impossible for you. Now, let me answer that first question that came up. It was asked to me in the very beginning. If God doesn't answer my prayer, is it because I don't have faith? You know, oftentimes God answers our prayers and we don't even know it. Hello? Have you ever prayed a prayer? Sometime long down the road, you go, oh wow, you did answer that prayer, didn't you? I've done that. I remember praying prayers. You know, this goes back just a few years ago when I was in college. I was short on money. I didn't have enough money to do anything. And I prayed, God, you know, I don't know what I'm going to do. Wasn't but a short time after, here comes something in the mail with my name on it, no return address. I open it up and there's some money inside of it. What I needed to pay the bills. Mm-hmm. I don't know who sent it. It didn't matter. I had prayed it, but before I even prayed it, God had to have already sent it. Mm-hmm. That's how God is. He knows your need before you even ask.
Yes, he does.
And he meets your needs. God doesn't always answer it the way that you want it answered. I didn't hear anyone say amen on that one. Got it? God doesn't always answer it the way you want it done. You know what? He knows better than you do what you really need.
Yes.
First, we must pray according to his will. Mm-hmm. We must pray according to his will. Second, I'll say in Matthew chapter 18, verse 19. Again, I say to you that if two or of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. The last thing, speaking of healing, I have prayed for non-believers and seen them healed. They didn't know what faith was all about. But as I was praying for them, God moved, God did work in their life and in their body. And keep in mind here, faith with confidence and assurance has to be a part of that prayer when we pray. Now, if there's anyone here this morning that has a mountain in your life mountain of fear, of unbelief, of anxiety, of health problems. Whatever that mountain is in your life, you know, we think, and as we read that scripture, the first thought is an actual mountain. And I want to give you an illustration of that mountain. Some of you have heard this before. In Riedel, many years ago, at the Assembly of God Church here in Riedel, Pastor began praying literally that God would move a mountain. They needed a mountain moved so that they could have more parking in there for the church. One day, the guy that owned a construction company, a road building company, came by the pastor's house and says, "Pastor, I understand you need a mountain moved." Guess what? God moved that mountain. He used somebody that had all the equipment necessary to move that mountain. So God moves physical mountains when you pray. And God moves those mountains that you have in your life. God can answer that prayer. If you want effective prayers, exercise your faith. Put your faith into action. Just like that mustard seed, your faith must grow. When you ask God for one thing and you see that answer, then you can ask for something a little bigger because your faith is growing. Once you see that answer, then you see something bigger. You ask for something bigger. God will answer those prayers. As you exercise your faith, you see God answering your prayers. And you begin praying something bigger and bigger and bigger. And I want to encourage us this morning to pray big prayers. Like Jabez prayed, "God, expand my territory. God, make my sphere of influence," whatever it is. And at the end of that prayer, it says, God did that. Pray something so big that you know you can't take care of yourself. Because if you can take care of yourself, take care of your prayer yourself, maybe you need to do that. But pray something so big that even you can't take care of it, and then God has to. You know, I think that when we pray big prayers, I think it excites God. Yeah, I really did. I think it is exciting for him. He's going, "Yes, they're putting their trust in me now. They're not just going to try it themselves again. They're trusting in me." So I want to encourage you this morning again. Begin praying big prayers in your life. Many of you have needs in your life that you know you can't do it on your own. Ask God for those big answers and for those big prayers. Yes. Amen?
Amen?
Let's do it this morning. I'd like you to stand with me.